bringing us together again. Lord, month after month, you teach us your word. And as the Gospel of John, chapter 8, 31, 32 says, when my word continues in you, you shall be my disciples. When my word abides in you, you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Tonight, as we are gathered here, O Lord, we ask you, Father, to reveal the truths that are hidden from this world through your holy scriptures. Help us to apply them in our day-to-day life so that these truths will not only set us free, but we in turn can teach others how to be free. We thank you, we praise you, Lord, that each one of us have come with different issues. Some with problems in their body, some in relationships, some in finances, but surely something or the other. But tonight, Father God, we have come to receive the truth from you and apply that truth in our day-to-day life and experience that victory. Because it is your will for your children to live a victorious life. We ask you for that wisdom, and your word in James 1 says that you give this wisdom to everyone who asks, generously, ungrudgingly. So here we are asking you for wisdom of your kingdom, so that with this wisdom, we will turn around this affliction into glorious testimony. Lord, make this preaching and teaching absolutely simple and easy to understand, so that we are able to apply it in our day-to-day life and experience practically your presence. We hear your voice and follow you. Thank you, Father, for the great signs, wonders, and miracles that you are going to perform tonight. And you are the one who is going to confirm every word that is being preached tonight with accompanying signs and wonders. Yes, Father, we thank you, we praise you in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
You know what was interesting in this prayer? When I spoke about the truth, nobody said amen. When I spoke about wisdom, nobody said amen. But when I said about healing, everybody said amen. Healing is the fruit. Truth is the root. So if you get the root right, the fruit will always be right. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Tonight we are going to study a very beautiful topic, and I have been preaching this topic again and again and again and again everywhere I go. Because, you know, in life, we have experienced Jesus, and might be we going through different issues of life, and we are really praying hard, but in spite of praying hard, things don't turn in our favor, and then comes frustration. Then comes a question, why, Lord? Why this in my life? Praise God. So tonight, God is going to answer us through the Holy Scriptures. He is in the court. We are going to ask him the questions. And praise God, he's going to give us the answers. So by morning when we leave from here, we have got practical answers. Why? And after knowing the answers, we can put them in our life and experience a great future. Praise God. So shall we pray to God to give us victory?
Yes.
In our everyday life?
Yes.
The answer goes wrong. 1 John chapter 5, verse 4. Somebody said it right. See, these are the truths that we got to learn them and put them in our system. Hello. We got to learn the scriptures, know the truth, and apply the truth in our everyday life. Now I just said, let's pray to God that He will give us victory. And everybody said, yes. Now what's the truth? Please read that.
1 John 5:4.
1 John 5:4. I am getting annoyed because I ask questions. The questions are not asked to point fingers to anybody, but by asking questions we come to know that all these years what I was thinking is to be right is absolutely not right. Praise God. In God's kingdom it does not depend on people's opinion or anybody's opinion. It depends on the truth, and that is the word of God. In God's kingdom it does not depend on majority. In God's kingdom, it's the truth, and the truth will set you free. Praise God.
Before
that, let's go to Gospel of John 8, please. Then we'll come here. Gospel of John 8, 31. Let's start with 30, brother. And Jesus spoke these words, many
believed on Him.
A quick revision, what is believe?
Action plus
words. The message, praise God. So when I say I believe, then my action should correspond to that message. So here were some, there were many who believed on Him, means when He spoke something, they were quick to receive the message and put it into practice. So Jesus spoke these words. Many believed on Him. Then said Jesus to those Jews who believed on Him. Are you believing in Jesus?
Yes.
Yes. Otherwise you wouldn't have been here tonight.
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
Praise God. If you continue in my word, if you
continue in my word,
then you are my disciples indeed. What does the meaning of the word continue?
To read the word, continue, speak the word, read the word,
play from. No. See, when the pressure comes, you are believing for something. When the pressure comes, there's a tendency of getting into doubts, the tendency of getting into fear, there's a tendency to do things opposing to God's word. Okay? So here he says, if you continue in my word, for example, let's say the mother-in-law hurt the daughter-in-law 20 years back, but the daughter-in-law is still remembering the mother-in-law's words. So what is she doing? Now you understood? So what is continuing God's word?
Remaining in
that word, focusing on that word, meditating on that word. So if you continue in my word, then you are my disciples indeed. And you shall know the truth, and you shall know the truth, and the preacher shall make you free. What is he saying? So what do you need tonight?
The truth.
Or the preacher to come and lay hands on you.
Truth.
What do you need?
The truth.
And where do you get this truth?
From the word of God.
The word of God. Praise God. See, today, tonight, we will have a theory, we will have a practical. Okay? But what you hear and what you see, you got to go home and practice. For example, I just came, I went inside, and I tasted the snacks. Okay, You were amazingly good. Praise God.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So I tasted. Okay? And it's very good. Now some of you after tasting will ask, who has prepared this? And then you will go and ask that person what? This you know. Now after taking the recipe, what will you do?
Try
it. And if there is some error and the quality is not good, you will call up and ask, see, listen, it came out this way, what do I do? Amazing taste, juicy. Hallelujah. So you know something has come from here, because I looked at her and I said, amazing taste, juicy. So some of your appetite must have increased. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So just as you want a recipe, and if you follow the instructions in the recipe, do you get the same product?
Yes.
Come on.
Yes.
So if you see the preacher's life is good by following the instructions, and might be your life is not so good, so what do you need to do? Follow the instructions, the truth, not the preacher. Not the preacher. The preacher's job is to make you understand the truth. Praise God.
Yes.
Practically. And when you abide in that truth, the truth will set you
free.
So will the truth set us free?
Yes.
Only if you apply. Conditions applied. So you can write down the notes, what I will give you tonight. But next month when I come, you open the book again. Will that truth that you have written in your notebook set you free?
No.
So many a times we hear people saying, come for the night vigil and your whole life will change. Nothing will change. Don't be deceived. It is only when you apply the truth will set you free. Praise God.
Praise God.
When I read this, I was extremely happy, because in those days I was not preaching, I was studying the word. And I said, Lord, it's so good, because if it was preacher will set you free, there are very few preachers in town. But if the truth sets me free, then I don't need a preacher. I don't need a preacher only to teach me and give me the recipe. That's all. That's the work of the preacher. The rest is me and the Holy Spirit. He is the one who will teach me how to put those instructions into practice. And when I practice and practice and practice, just like today, how your chapatis are? And the first chapati was like papad.
India
man. Amoeba. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So practice will?
Make you perfect.
Set you free. Praise God. Okay, let's go to 1 John. So is that clear? What do we need tonight?
Practice the truth.
1 John 5:4. For whatsoever, come on, read it, please.
For whatsoever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith.
So, who will give you the victory?
Our faith.
Whatsoever is born of God.
Who will give you the victory?
God.
I'll go home. Please give me the answer from that scripture. Who will give you the victory?
Our faith.
Who will give you the victory?
Our faith.
Okay, read from there. This is the victory. Come on, read from there.
This is the victory that overcomes the world. Even our faith.
So who is going to give you victory?
Our faith.
All this time, what are you thinking?
Faith.
Everybody needs to go for confession. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now, please listen attentively. We were all born from the womb of our mother. And our first parents, Adam and Eve, disobeyed God. And therefore, they were slaves of Satan, And every child born from that time till today is born in the kingdom of darkness. So every child coming from the womb of a mother comes by default in the kingdom of darkness. And now that same child, when the child is baptized, the kingdom of darkness is cancelled and the child is translated into the kingdom of Jesus through baptism. Okay? So when we were born by default to be slaves of the world. But now when we got born again, when did a person get born again? Okay. There's another scripture, 1 Peter 1:23. You read it. Being born again, not of the corruptible seed, but of the incorruptible,
by the word of God, which is living and abides forever.
So, how are we born again according to 1 Peter 1:23?
Incorruptible
seed, the living and abiding word of God. So, when somebody preached to us about Jesus, were you able to see the physical Jesus? No. The person who preached to you, had he or she seen the physical Jesus? No. So when this gospel was preached about a man named Jesus, his birth, his death, his life, his death, his burial, his resurrection, we made a choice to believe what was unseen. And the day we made that choice to believe what was unseen, that very moment, in a fraction of a second, the Spirit of God came into us and we got what?
Born again.
We got
born again.
And from the time we got born again, now we are all the time thirsting and thirsting and thirsting and thirsting for spiritual food. Praise God.
Praise God.
So the day we got born again, there was a very powerful miracle that took place instantly within a second. And that miracle is, God the Holy Spirit came to dwell in our spirit, and because of which the fullness of God is coming to us. The faith of God is coming to us. The love of God is coming to us. In other words, the very nature, the character of God has come into us and is in us, that is in our spirit. Praise God.
Praise God.
So this power that has come into our spirit is the power that overcomes the world. In other words, in today's world where there is a cricket match, sometimes they say there is a match fixing. Have you heard that?
Yes.
In other words, God for his children has done match fixing. How? He has already put his creative power in our spirit by which, by default, we are supposed to have victory in our life. And that's why he says, just put that scripture again, 1 John 5:4, that whosoever is born of God, I was born from my mother's womb, but now we are all born from the Heavenly Father's womb. And because we are born from the Heavenly Father's womb, we are overcomers. We are designed to overcome, and we overcome by our faith. Praise God. Now the next question would be for a person saying, hey, if you say that this power is in me, then first thing, I can't feel this power. Two, if this power is in me, then how come I do not have victory in my life. I get beaten up. Sickness comes and destroys me. Emotions come and destroy me. Relationships come and destroy me. Finances-wise, I'm destroyed. I've got so many bad habits, so many weaknesses. And you say that I have victory. How does this happen? Now, the Bible says that when God created man out of the dust, He breathed His breath into man. So when He breathed His breath into man, that breath gave man a spirit by which he became alive. The dust became alive. So the natural, that is the dust of the earth, the breath of God, which is spiritual, they both came together, and when they came together, out of these two came the soul, the mixture of the natural and the spiritual is my soul. Praise God. So now there are three parts: the body, which is natural, the spirit, which is spiritual, and the mixture of these two is the soul, which is emotional, which is mental. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So when God created man, His spirit was perfect, His soul was perfect, His body was perfect. There was fullness of God in His spirit, there's fullness of God in His soul, there's fullness of God in His body, and therefore man had no sickness, no disease, and he was supposed to live forever. Now, when man disobeyed God, the fullness of God that was in the spirit got corrupted. And when the spirit got corrupted, the soul got corrupted. When the soul got corrupted, the body got corrupted, and therefore death came into this body. Is this all right?
Yes.
Okay. Now when we are born from our mother's womb, our spirit is born in corruption. It has got no desire for God. It's a rebel. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So when the spirit is corrupted, the spirit has trained our soul to be corrupted. Because we are living in this world and our soul receives knowledge every day. Even right now, we have come here to receive what? Knowledge of the kingdom of God. Praise God. And every day, wherever we are working or wherever we are, we also get knowledge of the world. So whether we like it or not, our eyes, our ears, our five senses communicate to us and give us different kinds of knowledge. Praise God.
Praise God.
Now, where comes the problem? The problem comes when a person who is born again does not live by spirit. Let me give an example. Here are three people. Okay? Let's say she is the spirit. My brother is the soul, and my other brother is the body. Now the spirit is the real person, so the spirit is the boss. So she is the boss, she comes to my restaurant. This boss comes to the restaurant. So the steward comes and says, "What will you have?" So she says, "I want masala dosa." Okay, so he takes the order, writes it, and gives it to the waiter. And after some time, the waiter comes and serves her vada sambar. Serves her
vada sambar.
Now, what did she order? And what was served?
Vada sambar.
Where was the error?
The body.
Body.
Listen. He took the order. When he writes down there, does the spirit see what he wrote?
No.
You see? Do you peep what you wrote? Show me. No. Now he wrote, what are some one?
He wrote.
So please understand, the body only takes order from the soul. The body cannot take its own order. The body can never take order from the spirit, because it has got no connection with the spirit. I told you the soul is interlinked between the body and the spirit. Is that clear?
Yes.
So the spirit is all the time going to demand or speak spiritual things of God when the person gets born again. But this soul has been trained for so many years in the world, with the knowledge of the world. So even though the spirit said masala dosa, the soul will say vada sambha. Now who is the boss? The spirit or the soul? So the day our soul becomes the boss, our life is miserable.
Yes.
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 The day the spirit is the boss, our life is awesome. So when the spirit is the boss, the soul will only take what the spirit says and tell the body to do exactly what the spirit says. The person's life is high spiritual life. So the more and more the soul becomes full of the spirit, or full of God's word, full in submission to God, the body becomes more and more healthy. I always had a question which I had not got answer for so many years. How come, Lord, there are saints in the Catholic Church, they have died centuries back and their body has not decayed? And I found the answer is, these saints, even though they were born like us in corruption, when they got born again, they began to train their soul to be more and more and more and more submissive to their spirit. So their soul became fullness of God. So when the soul became fullness of God, the body also became fullness of God. And that's why their body doesn't decay. Are you understand?
Yes.
So if your soul is corrupted, before you can die, your body will already start decaying. For example, a person is full of depression. The person might be 30, but full of depression. Doctor, how will the person look like?
Tired, lethargic.
No, age-wise.
Yeah, more age.
More age. And another person is full of God. Might be 50. How will that person look?
Glowing.
Younger.
Younger.
Praise God.
Praise God.
So you can put all the watercolors. Spend all your money. Praise God. On the outside you can put a lot of things, but if the corruption is inside, it will show on the outside. Yeah?
Yes.
So here is God saying that everyone sitting here are by default overcomers of the world. And that power that we need to overcome the world is our faith. So let's take, for example, today we had the whole day. In the whole day, how much time did we live where the spirit said dosa and the soul said vada sambha? So most of the time in a whole day, if we have to take a score, who was ruling our life? The spirit or the soul? Who was that spirit? Photo likalo? So now we understand where we need to change. That's why what happens is, in our spirit we know that this is what God wants us to do. But our soul is always going to retaliate. And that's where we got to renew our mind and bring that soul to submission to God. And only when my spirit becomes the boss, that this body is used for the kingdom of God. But when my soul becomes the boss, then this body will see to it that damages everybody around me. There's a big difference of people in the Gulf and people in India. During summer, people in India, they are not in AC. But in Muscat, in Gulf, wherever you are in
AC.
So your mind is all the time cool. That's why you are able to perform cool.
Cool.
That's why the husband is
cool.
Wife is
coolest.
Yes. Yeah. Why is it? Because the
AC.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
But in India, we are sweaty, sweaty, sweaty. Hot, hot, hot. So if you want to save your marriage in AC in India, buy them.
AC.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
See, when I'm speaking God's word, everybody becomes serious. When I put a little joke, everybody becomes so fresh. Why? Soul. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
So, by default, is our faith going to give us the victory?
Yes.
Come on.
Yes.
Now, what is faith?
A short
in simple words, faith means, in simple, absolutely simple words, when a person is thinking, imagining, or acting, or putting it into action, anything that is in line with God's word, having no conviction or no evidence in the physical realm, that's called faith. When a person is thinking, imagining, or putting anything in action that is in agreement to God's word, but at the same time having no evidence, no physical evidence in his favor, then it is called faith. How many of you believe Satan is in this house? Doctor, you are inviting these people to your house. They are saying Satan is in this house. Just look at her. How many of you are saying Satan is in this house? Lift your hands up. And look at doctor and the husband, both are lifting two hands up. So now this will be the talk in the church. You know, don't go to doctor's house. Now why do you think some people lifted their hands, some people did not? Satan is in this house. He's everywhere. But now is he present?
Yes.
Look at the person who has invited. Okay, why are you so sure? Sorry?
You know, she's saying he's there. I said, I think she brought him along.
No. I want to tell you, wherever I go, Satan comes with me. Now some of them will go to church and say, that brother came and said, wherever I go, Satan comes with me. I'm speaking from the evidence that is in the word, that when the word of God is preached, Satan comes at once. Praise God.
Praise
God. So how do I know Satan is here? I know that Satan is here because I've got spiritual evidence in the Word, and I choose to agree to it, believe it, so I know that Satan is here. Can I see him?
No.
No. But is he there?
Yes.
Surely there. Praise God.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So in doctor's house, Satan lives? He comes only when the Word of God is preached. After that, he is not there. But what happens is they both are listening to the Word of God day and night. So is he there?
Permanently.
Praise God.
Praise God.
So does she need to be scared now that Satan is here?
No.
Why not? The Word of God is the light. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now, hasn't this truth set us free?
Yes.
So when somebody says, I see some darkness in your house, you got to say in everybody's house where the Word of God is being heard, darkness is coming over there. But darkness has no power over there because the light is in our heart. For greater is he
that is in me than he that is in the world.
John 1.
John
1. John 1. 4.
Yeah, yeah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Has anybody ever been anxious any time in their life? Worried any time?
Yes.
How many years back?
Today also?
Yes. Somebody was worried, what if he doesn't come? Praise God.
Praise God.
So what is worry? Worry is nothing but thinking anything and everything that is not in agreement with God's word. Praise God.
Praise God.
So, did you understand what is faith?
Yes.
So, whenever you have to speak faith, do you need any evidence?
No.
How many of you came to this house by stairs?
Came
nobody. How many of you came by elevator?
All of us.
And when you got in, what did you see there?
P.
P. What is that P? Parking. Okay, okay. Now the question. See, listen. We'll study about faith, okay? When you got into the lift, you are on the ground floor. Okay? And you want to go to the penthouse. Now there were three numbers and then P on top. Right?
Yes.
Did you press P?
Yes.
Could you see from down?
No.
But did you press?
Yes.
What if you say, I will press only what I see? I will believe only what I see. So you have to believe only ground floor because you can't see the penthouse. But even though you could not see, you still clicked on the desire that you wanted. And because it was there, P, you clicked on it. And when the door opened, it was P. Now if you have to be on G, and press G when the door closed. And when the door opens, where would you be?
G.
So when a person speaks what he sees, he's always on the? And a person who looks into the Bible, but if it is naturalized, he can't see, but he agrees to it, speaks it, and acts on it, they are the ones who reach the P. So when a person speaks, acts, on what he can't see, just as the elevator carries you, and when the door opens, you reach your destination. In the same way, faith also works the same way, but he wants you to click P and not G. When you're worried, you're pressing what?
G.
Ask your neighbor, today, how many times did you press G? And as long as you're pressing G, the door closes, the door opens, the door closes, the door opens, and you're still there. And then you're saying there's something wrong with the elevator. There's something wrong with faith. There's nothing wrong with faith. There's something wrong with you because you speak what you see. You speak what you hear. You speak what you feel. And God's word says, if you want victory in life, You speak what you with what I show you in my word. You hear my words. You move by my words. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
So all our life, we have lived on seeing. See, when your soul is the boss, your soul will always want to see and believe. When the spirit is the boss, then the spirit says, I don't care what I see, I only believe what God's word says. And as long as Satan can get you into the natural realm, he can defeat you every game. Every game he can play chess with you and checkmate. But if you're playing a game with him, which is on the spiritual side, he can never defeat you. And that's what our whole Christian life is. Our whole Christian life is no longer asking God to give me, but learning how to release what God has already given me, which is in my spirit, and therefore we are overcomers. The power that is needed to overcome this world is already in us. And this power can be released only by faith. The power to heal you from incurable disease is already in you, the day you got born again. But as long as your soul rules your life, you will be having the power, but not be able to use the power. Okay? Yes. This we will learn on the B part or the later part of the night vigil. Okay? Now let's see where's the problem. Are you ready?
Yes.
Somebody might say, if I was during the time of Jesus, a disciple of Jesus, and I would have moved with Jesus like Peter and John, my faith would have been excellent. Because I would have seen it, I would have heard the voice of Jesus, I would have touched him, and my life would be beautiful. Now let's see what the Bible has to say about it. Am I going too fast?
No.
Are you understanding?
Yes.
So 2 Peter chapter 1, and please I pray that you will be able to overcome the spirit of unbelief. Praise God. Because when you read a scripture like this, it creates unbelief. Yeah, 2 Peter chapter 1. Are you ready?
Chapter 1.
2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. Okay. Simon Peter, come on, read it.
Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ.
To them that
have
obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God
and our Savior Jesus Christ.
So this letter is not written to everyone, but to those who like us. Peter is saying, like us, have obtained precious faith with us. In other words, he's writing this letter to those people who had never seen Jesus. They had never been with Jesus. But to them was the gospel preached. So here Peter is saying, I'm writing to those people who have never seen Jesus, but when the gospel was preached, they had received the faith which was just like us. In other words, he's saying the faith that we received by being with Jesus and the faith that you have received who has not seen Jesus is the same. Now what happens to your soul? Is it screaming, shouting, and saying, how can this be possible? This is possible because you look at the C part of that scripture. that they have obtained like precious promises with us. How? It was not our doing, but it was God's doing. In other words, this faith that God gave to these people was because of God's righteousness, or because of God's nature, or because of God's love. So if they had received this faith, then you and I have also received the same faith. Please look at that scripture and make a decision to agree to that scripture, not based on what you feel. Because your feeling will say, I can't have the same faith like Peter because I failed so many times. You failed so many times because your soul is corrupted. But that faith that you need is already in your spirit.
Yes.
Okay, let me put it this way. She's staying on the fourth floor, and on top is the tank. Water tank. The water tank is full. Praise God.
Praise God.
Now, if she opens the tap, which flows like drop by drop by drop, is the problem with the tank?
No.
Come on.
No.
Let's say the person on the ground floor opens the tap full. Now, whose bucket will be full first?
No.
Correct?
Yes.
Now, where's the problem? The problem is with the tank?
The pipe.
The tap, the opening of the tap. In the same way, the Lord is saying, just like the tank, that kind of faith I put in you. But if your soul does not agree to what I say, then that faith which is in you, which has the power to give you the victory, the power by which you can conquer the world, you can conquer your sickness, you can conquer your problem, that faith, you yourself, by your unrenewed, corrupted mind, has blocked the power to be manifested in your life. Did I go too fast?
No.
Did you follow? So where's the problem? Problem is with God, the problem is with the devil, or the problem is with my thinking?
With my thinking.
So from now on, can you go to God and say, God, give me? Or can you say to God, from now on, I'm going to train myself to agree to what you have given in your word. How did the miracle take place in Mother Mary's womb? When she agreed. So when you and I agree to anything that God has given in His word, having no physical evidence, that's the time the power of faith which is in us gets activated and brings forth the manifestation. So do you need more faith, or that faith is already given to you? Let's say there is 10 lakhs in your account and you want to withdraw 5,000 rupees. Is it difficult?
No.
50,000?
No.
3 lakhs?
No.
5 lakhs?
No.
8 lakhs?
No.
Because the deposit is already
there.
So please understand, the deposit of faith that is supposed to give you victory is already there. But to withdraw that faith, I need my soul to agree with God's word. See, when a person comes and says, pray for me, but at the same time, the soul is in disagreement. So the preacher uses his faith and gets the person healed. Praise God. But will that person ever be able to draw from his own faith? No. So the preacher comes and is with that person one day a month. But what about the other 30 days? Are you following what I'm saying?
Yes, yes, yes.
But if that same person says, come on, preacher, I don't want you to use your faith. I want you to teach me the truth so that I will go back home, renew my mind, work on my mind to submit to my spirit and agree to the word of God and learn from that, and I'll come back with the result.
Yes.
Are you following?
Yes.
Otherwise you'll become a slave of people. But if you learn to use your faith, then praise be to God. Life will become beautiful. Now, I remember last month when that lady had a deaf ear. I called you. Now, when I called you and I said, open this deaf ear, you said, me? Now, why did you say me? Because you don't know the faith that is in you can open. So I could have prayed and finished the job. But I said, I'm going to teach you. So what did you do? You used the words, agreed those words, spoke those words, believed those words, and the ear opened. Right? Now, after the meeting, there was another man who said, my not working. Right? What did you do? This time, you did not even wait for me. Why? How come in one day a person says, can I open deaf ear? After a few hours, when he gets another opportunity, he doesn't even wait for me. He puts his finger, does the job and says, yeah, it's done. So what happened now? Did he learn to use his faith or does he want to use the preacher's
faith?
Are you following?
Yes.
Is this topic interesting?
Yes.
Do you want to learn it?
Yes.
Yeah. So that, and make a decision, God, you teach me, so that when I learn, I will go and share the secrets to your children. Because God's secrets have to be shared. Imagine for this person who had a problem in a ear for more than 20, 30 years, having that power to heal a ear, but she did not know how to draw it out. I was in Vishakhapatnam and I was preaching on this. And the husband came and told me that his wife has got 100% blind eye and a deaf ear. So he said, pray over her. And I looked at her and I saw that she had attended no class. She had come that evening during the break. And he had seen a lot of healings taking place. So he said, pray over her. I said, no, let her attend the class and then I will pray. And as I was teaching the word of God, suddenly the Spirit of God said, now's the time. So I was giving some notes. And the notes said that the power in me, in my spirit, is the power that brings the fullness of God, that brings a total healing. So I asked her to read it again and again and again and again. She read it about 8 times. And then I said, now close the book and read it again. And she read it. She made some mistake. I said, open the book, read it again. Now close the book and read it again and say it again. So she had to understand before she can speak. So when she said it right, I said, come here, let's pray. And this husband came and whispered to me about her blind eye and the deaf ear. Nobody in the congregation knew it. When the whole prayer was over, she got 100% vision, she got 100% hearing. And I said to the people, if this husband had to say that my wife is 100% blind, 100% deaf, what would be the reaction of the people there? Faith or unbelief? Would the soul speak or the spirit speak?
Soul.
And I was so thankful to the husband and I said, thank God you spoke in my ears. Nobody knew it. So everybody were moved by faith. And within 1.5 minutes it was done. Praise God.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So when that happened, another man who was sitting there with 80% vision loss, he comes to me and says, I got 80% vision loss. Did you see what happened? He said, yes, only in one eye. And praise God, the next moment his eyes opened. So tonight we are going to see lots and lots of healings, not because I am going to pray, but because you shall know the truth and the truth will set you free. So tonight we are going to study how to open the tap of the fullness of God that is in our spirit, so that it will manifest in our body and from our body manifest in this world, in the natural realm, in the lives of others. Praise God.
Praise God.
Interested?
Yes.
Okay, let's go to, is that clear?
Yes.
That we have the same measure of faith. If you go to Romans chapter 12 verse 3, he speaks about the measure of faith. Just take to me. Romans 12, 3. For I say through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God has given to every man a measure of faith.
The measure of faith.
Now, is Jesus called a true vine or the true vine?
The true vine.
Is he called a good shepherd or the good shepherd?
The good shepherd.
Is he called the light of the world or the light of the world?
The light of the world.
Why is it so important about the word the?
The only.
The one and only. In the same way, when he says he has given to every man, is it there?
Yes.
God has dealt to every man
the same measure.
So is he given to every man?
Yes.
What about the woman?
Yes.
All.
But there it is man. Yeah, wherever the woman is not there, where they want, they will say, yeah, everywhere.
Woman came from man.
Woman came from man. Correct. Man had the first cessation. His rib was removed. Praise God. Okay, so man and woman both included. So every man is given the
measure.
So, do we all have the same measure of faith?
Yes.
Then why is there difference of manifestation? There is difference of manifestation because of difference of thinking, difference of knowledge, difference of agreeing, difference of believing. Hello?
Yes.
Difference of imagination. So that difference is the difference of opening the tap. In other words, this scripture says the power to given to everyone is the same. So God loves everyone and he has given to everyone the same measure of faith. So if the same measure of faith is in me, then why is it not manifesting? It's not manifesting because I have not renewed my mind. That's why you see some people, you give them soft drink, they can finish that soft drink in 1 hour. And if you give me soft drink, once I touch the lip, it has to be glass over. I can't drink sip by sip. Even if I try, it goes like water. Hello?
Yes.
Have you seen some people, they can drink and drink and drink, and after 1 hour or so, something will they leave and go.
Yes. Sip by sip.
So the more and more you agree to God's word, there is no sip by sip. In one gulp, it's over. That means the fullness of God is operating through you. But if there is no agreement to God's word, the mind is not renewed, your soul is ruling over you, then it's slow by slow, sip by sip. Praise God.
Praise
God. Okay, let's take some examples from the Bible. Matthew chapter 17 and verse number 14. I was given special instruction by Brother Alfred. when you come to Muscat, you must talk on this topic, no other topic. because he has been listening to this topic and he said, brother, this topic has made such an impact in my life, I would request you, wherever you go, for 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, you only speak this topic. Even if people say he doesn't know any other thing, let them think, brother, but you take this topic again and again so that it gets into our system. How many times did you hear belief and unbelief?
Many.
Many a times. And still not bored?
No, bro. Every time new things.
Every time you are learning new things. Yes, sir. So I was given instructions, so before getting down, I know what I'm supposed to preach.
I requested.
Yeah, requested, brother. Praise God. Because he got so much blessed with this topic that he said, brother, this is the topic that everybody needs to hear. And I want to tell you, tonight, the demons are already screaming on top of their voice because they are getting tormented because the truth sets you free. Praise God.
Praise God.
Okay, here we go. Matthew 17 verse 14. And when they were come on, I want you to read.
And when they were come to the multitude, they gave to him a certain man kneeling down to him.
Can you read a little slower? You all are reading so fast. How you all understand reading so fast? Read as slow as you can. And when they were come to the multitude, they gave to him
a certain man kneeling down to him and saying, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is a lunatic
and so bad, and for often times he falls into the fire and often into the water. And I brought him to thy disciples, and they could not cure him. Then Jesus answered and said, O faithless and most generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you?
Bring me here to me.
Praise God.
Praise God.
Now what did Jesus say? O faithless and perverse generation. Now Jesus said this verse to his
disciples.
Jesus said this verse to whom?
Disciples.
To his
disciples.
Disciples. 14th verse, put that 14th verse. Put the 14th verse, please. Yeah. Who came and knelt down? Okay. Who was saying, who was speaking now to Jesus? The Father. Verse number 16, who was speaking? Okay. So who answered whom?
Jesus answered the Father.
So just because I said Jesus said to his, you put the fill in the blank. Disciple. Now was Jesus speaking to the disciple or to the Father?
Father.
What did he say? Faithless. Okay. Verse number 18.
And Jesus
prayed to God and said, God have mercy on this father's son and please heal him. And he pleaded and pleaded and pleaded till he could not cry anymore. God saw Jesus' tears and said, your tears have moved me. And therefore the child was cured from that very hour. Sorry, what happened?
Not tears on the devil.
Huh?
Nothing you can see there.
Now, Do you see the advantage of having a Bible? When I was reading something wrong, you said, no, that's not right. In the same way, when somebody says something to you and you have read it, you have seen it with your eyes in the Bible, you will quickly say, that's not true. Good. Now, Jesus rebuked the devil. Is it there?
Yes.
How many times have you rebuked the devil and how many times have you gone to God and spoken about the devil? Hello? There's a time that we got to talk to God and there's a time we got to learn to talk to the devil. Most of the time, what are we doing?
Complaining to God.
Talking to God about what?
About the devil's.
About the devil. About the devil's work. Okay, about the devil's work. Now, did Jesus go and speak to God about the devil's work?
No.
He rebuked the devil. So, what are we supposed to do? Do we do that?
No.
Okay. Jesus rebuked the devil and he departed out of him and the child was cured from that very hour. Then came the disciples. So the disciples were trying. They did not get success. Okay. So the father came to Jesus and said, the condition of my boy is so bad that your disciples could not do anything. Now Jesus rebuked the devil and the devil went. Now, question. Did the disciples before this had cast out demons?
Yes. Yes.
Did they have powerful healing ministry?
Yes. Yes.
And therefore, they were surprised. How come Jesus spoke a word and it obeyed? How come when we spoke the word in your name, he did not obey? So then came the disciples to Jesus apart and said,
Why could not we cast him out?
And Jesus said to them, because
of your unbelief.
Because of your unbelief. Hold on. One problem is of the son. And there are two people. The father wants to get his son healed. The disciples also want this child to be healed. Both of them have that same desire. But to two people, Jesus is giving two different explanations. To the father he is saying, faithless. To the disciple he is saying,
Unbelief.
Why is he not saying faithless to his disciples?
They believe in the Lord. They have renewed their mind.
What is unbelief? Unbelief is when a person is focused on anything that is contradicting to God's word is unbelief. Right? I'll give a simple example so that you understand. Last month I had been for a night vigil in Chennai. So the house where I'm staying, there's a grandma. And this grandma prays practically the whole day. I don't know what she prays, but all the time you'll find her with a rosary in her hand, old lady. And she will be chanting, murmuring something. Now 5 months back, she fell down and broke her leg and they had to put some nuts and bolts and got her operated. And supernaturally, you can say that she's completely healed. She can stand on her leg. She can lift her leg. She can move her leg. So when I looked at her, I asked her all these questions and I said, is it paining? She said, no. Are you able to walk? She said, yes. And everything is all right. Then I said to her, how come you are using a walker? if she is praying, if she is healthy, then why is she using a
walker?
She said that every time I have fear that I might fall again, with my past experience of what I suffered, I don't want to take any chance. So, is this mama having fear?
Yes.
Is she imagining something that has not happened, but something that will happen in the future which will be negative?
Yes.
So I asked her a question. Do you believe God is loving you? She said, yeah. Do you believe He is the creator? Yes. Do you believe He is powerful? Yes. Do you believe He is a healer? Yes. Do you believe He has poured His love into you? Yes. Do you believe He has given you the Holy Spirit? Yes. Do you believe He delivers you? Yes. Do you believe He protects you? Yes. Everything was yes. If everything is yes on this side, at the same time, there is negative on the other side. So is it possible for a person to know the scriptures on one side and worry on the other side?
Yes.
So when a person is worried on the other side, that's the time the person is growing unbelief, and that unbelief will stop your faith. So in other words, Jesus did not tell the disciples, listen, you got problem with your faith. No. Your faith is so big and so powerful, it can move a mountain. That's not the real issue. The real issue is your soul is focused on circumstances and situations and is disagreeing to God's word and agreeing to your situations. When that happens, it gives growth to unbelief. Is there a chance for a person to go to church every day and still grow unbelief?
Yes.
Is it possible for a person to sit right in front of the Blessed Sacrament and still grow unbelief?
Yes.
So in our prayers, especially under pressure, what do we grow? Faith or unbelief?
Unbelief.
So where's the real issue? The real issue is unbelief. But what will the devil say? The devil will say, your faith is too weak. And therefore, you have to build up your faith. Your prayer is too weak. Therefore, you have to pray more. So now you get up 3 o'clock in the morning to pray. Why? Nighttime, everybody is sleeping, no hotlines. God can answer your call easily. Daytime, there are so many calls. Hello?
Yes.
Line is busy. And you know what? God has got nothing to, He doesn't sleep. He wants some company. And you get up and you give Him company. He says, good. And now you're getting up at 3 o'clock in your sleep. Jesus. And you're praying. With that, trying to pray. Up to 4. Praise God. Nothing's happening. Now the devil puts in your mind, listen, your prayer at 3 o'clock is not good enough. You have to fast now. So, you are fasting. Now he says, listen, you got to kneel down. So, you are kneeling down. Now he says, you have to kneel at the door and go to the altar. Have you seen some people do that?
Yes.
So, you are doing that and you go up to the altar. Now you reached up to the altar, now you can't get up. Why? The knees are bleeding. Now you need another prayer. To get your knees healed. And in all this thing, the devil keeps putting in your mind, your faith. And God is saying, Jesus is saying, no. Faith has no issue. Your unbelief is what is cancelling the faith. Hallelujah. Now, unbelief can come through 3 different ways. First is ignorance. You don't have the knowledge. Okay? Is there anybody who has got any problem with joints? Why is it for the night vigil nobody comes with any problem? No. Anybody having any problem with joints? You got joint problem? Okay. Anybody else? Joint problem? Okay, you already stood. So let's have a demo. For how long have you got this? अच्छा छोटा ही है कोई बात नहीं 15 days now what scripture are you what are you praying or no
I praying
yeah what are you praying yeah what do you pray
prayer like something something simple prayer
yeah simple only
yeah
Prayer should always be simple. Yeah. Yeah, what is your simple prayer?
I can't explain, Mom.
Don't explain, only say the words.
Can I say in Konkani language?
Yeah, please, please, I understand Konkani.
Yeah. When I sorry, jed now deva chautar vasta vasala upran ame samche magne magala papa tuja pavitra sabdan tuja pavitra atmya sve tu mujhe tai mujhe bitar mujhe jivitant ailai papa tuja pavitra sabdan tuja pavitra atmya sve an tuja putra samje jo krista ja pavitra amali karta ja balan mujhe atmya tuma katai आणि तुझ्या मगाळा बापा म्हणजे जीवित तुझो सदांचो पवित्र आसरो हांवें तुका कर्ण दिवन चाक आणि दोर चाक तुझ्या पवित्र शब्दाची घटाय आणि तुझ्या पुत्र समजे तो ख्रिस्ताच्या पवित्र मध्ये रक्त सवें तुझ्या पवित्र आत्म्याचे रक्षण तू म्हज्या जीवितान तू म्हाका दिली आणि म्हज्या मगाळा बापा म्हज्या मोतीन म्हज्या मोतीच्या चिंपान म्हज्या मोतीच्या चिंपाच्या सत्येन म्हज्या काळजांत म्हज्या आत्म्यात म्हज्या अंतस्करणान म्हज्या कुडींत आणि म्हज्या जिवितान जिविताच्या वाटेर तुझ्या खुशे विरोध कितें सकट सकट राज करना आसा आनी तुज्या खुशे विरोध कितें सकट आडकळे राज करना आसा आनी तुज्या खुशे विरोध आमी जियेल्ल्या जिवितां मारपाक केल्ल्या सुखी सवें आदारलेलीं कितें सकट पातकां आनी पातकाची कथा आसात तीं सगळीं हांव तुज्या पुत्रा समजे तूं क्रिस्तच्या पवित्रा मदीं रक्ताच्या बळान आनी बापा तुज्या पवित्र आत्म्याच्या सत्येन हांव तीं सगळीं दोन तुका मोण उमटून हांव जेजूच्या नांवान तीं सगळीं म्हज्या तावन म्हज्या जिवितांत तावन भायर घालतां आनी तीं सगळीं बापा तुज्या पुत्रा समजे तूं क्रिस्ताच्या नांवान म्हज्या तावन ती सगळीं उमटून एकठांय करून जेजूच्या नांवान हांव जेजूच्या पांयान घालतां म्हज्या मोगाळा बापा तुज्या पुत्रा समजे तूं क्रिस्ताच्या पवित्रा मदीं रक्ताच्या बळान बापा तुज्या पवित्र आत्म्याच्या सत्येन हांव म्हाका संपूर्ण तरान जेजूच्या नांवान दोन नितळ निर्मळ कणकाण घेतां पवित्र कणकाण घेतां आनी म्हाका जेजूच्या नांवान सुटका जोडून आपणावन घेतां म्हज्या मोगाळा बापा ह्या म्हज्या मुखल्या जिवितांत हांवें जिवन आसता आसतना म्हज्या आत्मीक जिविता खातीर जाय आसल्यो हर एक रितीच्यो गरजो हांवें जोड आपणावन घेवच्या खातीर जाय आसलें बरें जिवीत हांवें जिवनच्या खातीर म्हाका जाय आसलो तुज्या शक्तीचो आदार आनी कृपा तूं म्हाका दी म्हणून हांव तुज्या लागीं तुज्या पुत्र समजेजू क्रिस्ताच्या नांवान मागतां म्हजें काळीज तुज्या पुत्र समजेजू क्रिस्ताचें सदांचें शाश्वत पवित्र बिडार हांवें ताका कर्ण दिवच्याक आनी दवरच्याक तुज्या पवित्र शब्दाच्या तुझ्या पवित्र शब्दाची घटाय आणि तुझ्या पुत्रा समजे तू क्रिस्ताच्या पवित्रा मध्ये रक्त असं हवेन तुझ्या पवित्र आत्म्याचे रक्षण या संसारांतल्या म्हज्या मुखल्या दिसाच्या जिवितच्या जीव नसता आसतना म्हज्या काळजाचेर तूं म्हाका दी म्हणून हांव तुज्या लागीं तुझ्या पुत्रा समजे तू क्रिस्ताचें नांव मागता बापा म्हजी कूड तुज्या
दिस इज युअर सिंपल प्रेयर
येस
Will you say a prayer that I will teach you?
Yes.
Say this, Psalms 22. No, just say that, say no. He'll put it. Psalms 22.
Psalm 22.
Verse 14.
Verse 14.
Says.
Says.
Jesus.
Jesus.
All your bones.
All your bones.
Were out of joint. Were out of joint.
Were out of joint.
By that pain.
By that pain.
My bones are completely healed.
My bones are completely healed.
Jesus.
Jesus.
Tujhi hada.
Tujhi hada.
Tujhe kushvetan.
Tujhe kushvetan.
Bhai sarli.
Bhai sarli.
त्या दुखीन तो
त्या दुखीन तो
मुझी हाडा
मुझी हाडा
बरी झाले
बरी झाले
आता मग जेजू
जेजू
तुझी सगळी हाडा
तुझी सगळी हाडा
तुझ्या कुश्वेतोन
तुझ्या कुश्वेतोन
बाय सरली त्या दुखीन तो
त्या दुखीन तो
मुझी हाडा
मुझी हाडा
बरी झाली
बरी झाली
म्हण तू
जेजू तुझ्या कुशेंतोन बाय सरली सगळी हाडा त्या तुझ्या हाडांच्या दुखीन तो मुझी हाडा बरी झाली
आता कर गेली
पण उणी झाली चिवरा सा
आपाने के पडी सा
जेजू तुझ्या खुशीची सर हाडा बाय सर तुझ्या खुशीच्या हाडांच्या दुखीन तो मुझी हाडा बरी झाली
आणि एक पडी
जेजू तुझ्या खुशीची सर हाडा बाय सर तुझ्या खुशीच्या हाडांच्या दुखीन तो मुझी हाडा बरी झाली
आता
जेजू तुझ्या खुशीच्या
खुशी नाही
तुझ्या खुशीची
तुझी सगळी हाडा तुझ्या कुशवेत बाय सरली
तुझी जेजू तुझी सगळी हाडा तुझ्या कुशवेत
बाय सरली
आणि तुझ्या हाडांच्या दुखीन तो मुझी हाडा ची दुख बरी झाली
झाली
असा अजून
थँक्यू जीसस Father, in the name of Jesus,
thank you, Jesus. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Praise you, Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus.
Nana, kiti asa? Asa, asa. Ata 20% asa?
30%
asa. Doesn't matter. Tu tahi boss, dhvanchi utaraik, tu ka... केला बाईस आता ते कळू चे इग्नोरन्स या करेक्ट इग्नोरन्स नाउ व्हेन आय डू नॉट नो द स्क्रिप्चर ओके विल आय बी एबल टू यूज माय फेथ
No.
So most of the time in our past life we never knew the scriptures and that's why our situation became worse because when we took decisions in life the decisions were contradicting to God's word and we got into problems and problems and problems because we believed the knowledge that we had received from the world we were ignorant of the truth and that's why what we believed to be right was actually not right and we made wrong decisions which led us into a mess so if a person has no knowledge of the word of god will he be able to walk in faith
no.
He is ignorant so he is suffering he has the power within him but he will never know of that power because he doesn't know the scripture. The second one is disbelief. First one is ignorance. Second one is disbelief. What is disbelief? Disbelief is when a person believes the knowledge that is given to him which is actually wrong but he believes to be true. For example, a preacher comes and says be careful when you lay hands on the sick that sickness will come on you not mentioned in the bible you don't need to lay hands on somebody for that sickness to come on you when you have worry, when you have fear, the affliction will definitely come on you, because wherever there is fear, Satan needs fear to work. Praise God. Faith brings God's manifesting glory. Fear brings Satan's work in your life. So, a wrong doctrine has been taught to you. You believe it. I remember one person, he had a problem with his wife. Okay? He's one of our team members. So when he had problem with his wife, the preacher told him, if you keep quiet, this wife will take advantage of you and all your life it will be like this. If she wants to go, let her go home. She'll learn a lesson, good lesson, and come back. Okay, he gave her that advice. And praise God, that's the time he attended one of our service. And what he learned was love. Now he had two things to do. Either believe what the other preacher said, or believe the truth that was given to him. So he made a decision to believe the truth. Okay? And as he began to believe the truth, he saw the first thing, that before his wife can change, he had to change. Okay? And he began to study God's word and all that. And then after years, he told me, hey brother, if I had to believe what that preacher had said, today my marriage would have been dissolved. And he's the same person who is preaching in Mysore, who has brought more than 700 to 800 families to God who are born Hindus. See? So, the teaching which was given to him was wrong and he believed it. So, there are many things that we hear from media or from the talk show or from here and there, and we get knowledge. And that knowledge might be contradicting to God's word. But you are believing. You are believing the lie of the devil, which you do not know it's a lie. You believe it's a truth. Praise God. Praise. I remember long many years back, I used to have Bible studies in Bombay, in Goa, in Mangalore. And, you know, never in my life had I ever heard international preacher preaching. So I came to know that there is a fire anointing conference of an international preacher. So I told all the students, come on, let's go. So we booked a bus from Bombay, bus from Goa, bus from Mangalore, and we all landed there. Now we were waiting for all the foreigners to come. Do you know who came? All Indians. So I began to wonder, they said international preacher. Then I realized, when a preacher goes abroad, he becomes international. Now I become international. I never knew that. I thought international preacher means somebody coming from abroad. Okay? Now, when we went there, what was being preached was the basic, and we were much
advanced
than that. But there was a problem there. There was all the time prophecies that were given. So every class after that, the preachers and their team would come, lay hands on people and prophesy. So in that prophecy, Alred was the only one who had no chance to go abroad. They said, you will be in India, you will never go abroad to preach. And among all the people, everybody was said, some is going to Germany, somebody is going to London, somebody is going here, somebody is going there. Now the prophecies were given. Okay? And now it so happened that each one is saying, which country are you going? Now after 16 years I'm seeing the prophecies that were given, not one of them came true, and the person who was supposed to be in India is now in Dubai. Are you following?
Yes.
Now when those prophecies were given, it took me 5 months to undo those prophecies. Because when somebody gives you a message, you get excited quickly. And there are something called as legal horoscope in the church. You know what's a legal horoscope in the church? The person says, pray over me after the prayer. Any vision? Any message? You know what's the message? The word of God is the message. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So when the person gives a message, for example, a person gives a message. This person comes for counseling and he had a very bad situation going on in his life, and the counselor lays hands on him and says, you know what? Your great-great-grandfather had committed a murder. And that's why there's a curse on your family. Praise God. He listens to it, and after 2 days, he meets with a small accident. What will come to his mind?
The curse.
The great-great-grandfather. Now, is the Bible saying that when Jesus died on the cross, he took away every person's sin, the sins of the whole world, except the great-great-grandfather? I never read in the Bible that Jesus took everybody's sin except that great-great-grandfather. So has Jesus paid the price for every sin?
Yes.
Including that murder of the great-great-grandfather?
Yes.
You know, the good news about Jesus is, what I found in my 16 years is, no matter what mess you have done in your life, the worst of the worst, Jesus says, doesn't matter. Come to me. Just repent. I still got a way. Not just to get you out of the problem, but to make you stand on top of the problem, that you will teach others how to come out of their problem. I will make you a master in that area, that once upon a time you were slave in that area. I will turn it around and make you a master. That's the good news about Jesus. You know what I find many preachers, when somebody has done something wrong, there's a curse on your life, there's a bondage on your life, there's this, there's that. Hey, come on, show me one person on this planet Earth who did not commit sin, and even after being born again, who does not commit sin. And you know what the Bible says? When we disobey God, a curse is activated. Every day curses are activated when we operate in sin. But praise be to God. Thanks be to the sacrifice of Jesus. That when we repent and ask for forgiveness, He not only forgives us, He gives us a brand new life.
Amen.
Praise God.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So only when a person changes his thinking and gets the truth sets him free. Otherwise, the lies of the devil, the person believes, and that believing is called disbelief. It gives rise to unbelief. So first one is ignorance, second one is disbelief, and the third one is natural senses. Natural senses. When it is natural senses, it is, we have been trained to live by our sight and by our senses. And if anything I see, I hear, I choose to believe that rather than believing the truth. So for me, the facts become more real than the truth. What's the difference between a fact and a truth?
Facts can change.
All those things that we see are facts. All those things that God has declared in His word are truths. So, anything that is contradicting to the truth is a fact. Praise God. And when you apply the truth on the fact, the truth has the power to change the fact and bring new facts in line with the truth. For example, a person suffering from cancer, it's not a truth, it's a fact. But a person believes, agrees, acts on the truth that by His stripes He is healed. Now this truth has the power to change the fact into a new fact that the person comes back healed. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So these three areas give rise to unbelief. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now let's see Mark, a similar situation, Mark chapter 9. Verse number 17. Are there? Mark 9:17. And one of the multitudes answered and said, Master, I have brought unto thee my son, which has a dumb spirit. And wheresoever he taketh him, he teareth him, and he foameth and gnasheth with his teeth, and pineth away. And I spoke to your disciples, that they should cast him out, and they
could not.
Jesus answered and said to him,
O
faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him to me. So Jesus spoke to whom?
To the
father of the son. Then they brought him unto him.
And when
he saw him, straightway the spirit tear him, and he fell on the ground and wallowed foaming. And he asked his father, Jesus asked his father, how long is it ago since this came unto him? And he said, of a child. And oftentimes it has cast him into the fire and into the waters to destroy him. But, read that slowly. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. And Jesus said to him, don't worry, I'm in charge over here and I will really help you. I have compassion on you. You don't have to fear anything. I will see to it.
No.
He put the ball in Jesus' court, right? If you can do something, Jesus, please have compassion and please help me.
So Jesus said
to him,
if thou canst believe
me. So is the ball in Jesus' court or in the man's court?
Man's court.
So your situation is in Jesus' court or your court? So Jesus is saying, listen. You don't come and tell me whether I can heal. As for me, I have done my part. The question is your part. Are you willing to believe? Are you willing to agree to what my word says? Are you going to agree to what your senses say? If you can believe, all things are possible to him that believes. Say that, all things are possible to me.
All things are possible to me.
Because I believe.
Because I believe.
Say that again.
All things are possible to me because I believe.
Now let's take for example, we have heard so many times Jesus say, when you lay hands on the sick, they shall recover. In my name, when you lay hands on the sick, they shall recover. How many of us truly believe that? And if we believe, won't we use our hands to go around and bless others and heal the sick? Won't you feel like going to the hospital and laying hands? Why is it when your loved one is sick, that's the time you want everybody to come and pray for your loved one? Why not when your loved ones are healthy and you are healthy, why don't you take 1 hour or 2 hours for a hospital visit and find some Christian? Don't go everywhere and create problems to others. But find a Christian in the hospital. Surely one Christian will be there in the hospital who is sick and lay hands and speak to that person. I know a Thai lady in Bombay. She and her husband, they are mid-60s. This Thai lady will prepare soup and go to the hospital. And she will make friendship with the patients and give them soup. And then with the friendship, then start praying and start giving them scriptures. And she started praying. And the patient started getting healed quickly. The hospital's doctor saw to it that she doesn't enter the hospital. not lie, really. And she was not a Christian. She said, brother, from the day I learned this, that my hands are anointed, I decided to go to the hospital every day. That's a part. Make soup in 2 thermos, tell her husband, let's go. Retired life. Finding Christians in the hospital. And she cannot be avoided, you see. If there is an Indian, people might not recognize us. She is a Thai lady. First of all, she speaks English that you don't understand. How you know. So I say, how do people, how does the patient understand English? She said that the patient doesn't understand, but the sickness understands my English. Anyway, when I'm going and laying hands on the sick, the sickness can understand what I'm talking, and the sickness has to leave. Amazing lady. Now what is she doing? Believing. And here Jesus saying, if you believe, all things are possible. And listen, if we are believing, all things are possible, then our life can never be natural. It has to be supernatural. That people can recognize and say, this is not ordinary. This is something beyond ordinary that is happening in your life. Because you are believing the super word and you are natural. And when you believe the super, your natural mixed with super becomes supernatural. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So is the ball in Jesus' court or in my court?
My court.
So what is God saying to us this tonight? Is God going to do it? Or is he saying, can you believe?
Can you believe?
See, God can do everything and he has already done it. There's one thing he can't do. That is our part. That is believe. That's why Jesus said to Martha and Mary, you remember?
Believe.
See, if you believe,
you
will see the glory of God.
John 11:40.
Praise God. Thank you, sister. So if we believe, we shall see the glory of God. So where's the problem? Problem is unbelief. Because we allow our soul, our senses, to disagree to God's word. Praise God.
Praise God.
Let's take a scripture.
Brother, this Mark 9:24, the Father.
And still give it the Father.
That is, help thou mine unbelief. What does it explain? Mark 9:24.
Yeah. And straightway the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe, help you my unbelief. See, in other words, he's saying, the very reason I brought my son to you is that I believe that you have the capacity to heal my son. But at the same time, my mind is filled with so much of doubts because of the past experience. I've taken my son to so many places, it did not work. My son, right from childhood, has been tortured by this spirit. We had never had a relief. So what I'm seeing, what I've had my past experience, is stopping me from believing what you're asking me to believe. I have not only taken him there, I have given him medicines. Doctors have tried to treat him, but there is nothing that has changed. In fact, everything has become worse. So on one side, your words, I believe. I also believe, Lord, that you have opened blind eyes. I know that. I know that you have been raising the dead. I know that. But when I look at the experience that I'm going through for so many years, those images are playing on my mind and that's creating unbelief. So please help my unbelief. And this is what happens in our life.
Now this unbelief is my decision, isn't it? Belief or unbelief. How he is asking Jesus to help him in this unbelief.
Yeah. Now I'll share with you how to cast out unbelief. But first we'll study on unbelief. I have not yet come there.
Okay.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So, do we understand where we are going?
Yes.
Okay. Now, let's take for example, now that you have probed me, let me just share a little on this. Do you get rain oil?
Yes.
Occasional. Occasional rain.
Is it drizzle or good rain?
Flood.
Okay. Good rain. Flood, so there is no drainage, it has to flood. No, but heavy rain?
Heavy rain.
Okay. You're going by car and all of a sudden it starts raining. Raining heavily that you can't see the glass. It's covered with water. Okay. What do you do? Do you stop the car?
Why you use the wiper?
Now why you use the wiper? Why do you use the wiper? But when the wiper blade goes from this side to that side, does the rain stop?
No.
Huh? So what's the use?
Yes, it's
helps us.
Help us.
Help us.
Here's a windshield.
But the rain is so heavy, sister. See, there are different speed for the wiper. One wiper will go like this and wait for a holiday, then come again, then a holiday.
Use a faster master.
So those are coming to Easter and Easter and Christmas time to church. Then there's another one going like this, and then like this. That's Sunday to Sunday. There's another wiper which goes like this. Okay? So you are using this wiper, right? Fast. Now the water is not stopping, it's going on pouring. But when you use the wiper, thank God you can see a little vision. But it, because it's continuously on, your vision is not impaired. You can still drive. Correct?
Yes.
The rain that is coming is the unbelief that is coming to your mind, the thoughts which are in disagreement. The wiper that you use is the words of agreement that comes out of your mouth. So when you get negative thoughts, do you open your mouth and speak your faith, or do you keep the wiper closed? So there are many people who use the wiper, right?
Yes.
Liars.
Not all.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now imagine Brother Alfred is driving the car with the wiper switched off. Okay? With judgment. You're driving, and then comes a big sound. What's the meaning?
Bang.
You hit the car, or you hit the lamppost, or you went down the road, something. Correct?
Yes.
In our life, when mouth opens without the vision, you have not used the wiper. So when you are opening your mouth, what words come out? Faith? Or dhamma dum 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 dum? Hello. So difficult to preach to the Christians. What words will come out, Baba? So another person on the other side also has not used wiper. Now what comes? Dham dhamma dham 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 dham. Correct? Now let's say the other person is using the wiper. And that person is not opening his mouth. And this person has not used the wiper. So dham, 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 dham. And that person is only cool. Now what happens?
Only one side
only. Yeah, one side only dham, dham. Then what happens? Oh, you have never experienced one side dham, dham and the other person is cool? Hello? One side is dham, dham, dham. The other person is not opening his mouth. What happens? Why are you not opening your mouth? You talk to me now! What are you keeping shut? Sorry.
She's enjoying laughing.
Okay. No. Worked on machines, no? I was worried about the table. Sorry, brother. Hallelujah. The other person is saying, open your mouth. Praise God. I don't know whether you heard the testimony of the husband and wife, 35 years of fight. Okay? The wife used to do dum, 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 dum. And the husband was on the scriptures. He would be cool. She would, the chairs and all would go flying. And if he's with the Bible, the pages would tear. And she would shake him up and say, open your mouth and talk to me. And he would be. Praise God. After 35 years, she understood that the problem was not with the husband, it was with her. 35 years she was thinking the problem is with husband. And she came to tell us that I want to share this testimony. We had never met each other. On the YouTube she was typing and on the typing, my video opened up, and for 3 years she has been listening to the word of God in Canada. And after listening, their marriage has become like, you know, this time they were on a honeymoon trip. So she told her husband, I want to go to India and I want to attend this retreat. I want to meet this man. And that's how they came to Goa. Praise God.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
So, what was I sharing? Wiper, use dum dum ni. Use it. Using the wiper. If you use the wiper, you are a person of patience. Have you ever been impatient?
Yes.
When you have been impatient, what was in your mind?
Negative.
So at that time, did you use the wiper?
No.
So what was the result? Brother Alfred, what was the result? Negative. When you were driving the car, dumb. And if the dumb is too big, then the cops also will come. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So do we need to use the wiper?
Yes.
And what's the wiper?
Word of God. Promises.
Yes, God. You are so smart here. So now, is it practical?
Yes.
Come on, is it practical?
Yes.
Come back. Let's close eyes. Let's reflect on all that we heard. Father God, we thank you for showing us that you want us to live by our spirit and not by our soul. You have blessed us with emotions to enjoy those emotions and feelings, but never allow emotions and feelings to rule our life and to lead us. Thank you that you have blessed each one of us with the same measure of faith. Thank you, Lord, that you love us so much that when we were born again, everything that we need in our life, you have already deposited in our spirit. And now we understand, O Lord, it is through our minds that we take possession of all that Jesus has done for us when he took our place on the cross. Father, we have failed to take possession that you have declared in your word. Possession that is our inheritance. And this inheritance is not because of our goodness, but because of your mercy and grace. And today you have taught us a very beautiful lesson, O Lord. That when we train our soul to agree to the Spirit, then everything of heaven that has been poured into our spirit is drawn out and is manifested in our life. Today you have made it absolutely clear why Satan attacks our mind. Why Satan attacks using our senses to bring disagreement and unbelief. Today you have shown us, O Lord, that it is extremely important for us to tame our mind. To stop our mind from drifting and wandering. To train and bring our mind to subjection, to obedience, to captivity, to the word of God. Today you have shown us, O Lord, that we who are born of God, we overcome the world. And this is what gives us victory. This is what makes us conquerors and champions our faith. And this battle of faith that we fight is always, always within our mind. And it is by the renewing of the mind. And how much we labor to bring this mind into agreement to God's word is what is extremely important in Christian life. And it is through this agreement, O Lord, we are able to draw out all that you have poured in our spirit and experience victory. So our life from now on is not gimme, Lord, but learning to draw out what has already been poured inside of us. Thank you for teaching us this truth, so that from now on we understand that renewing of the mind is the most important aspect in Christian life, in our spiritual life. We have failed in the past to renew our mind, believing that you, O God, are responsible to change our life. But tonight you have shown us, O Lord, it is the level to which our minds are renewed, is the level to which our lives are transformed and changed. Thank you for teaching us these truths that has set us free. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.